in my work of trying to create a model of consciousness based on my own research in consciousness, I came to the conclusion that the same rules that explain consciousness could explain this double slit experiment. Logically, nothing magic had to happen. I mean, after all, saying that a particle splits apart and interacts with itself, or it's intelligent, or it somehow gets information and knows where to go, I would call that magical answers. If somebody says, well, how does this work? The physicist might as well say magic. Because what magic is something that happens. You know it happens, but you have no idea how or why. That's magic. So the magician saws the lady in half, but somehow at the end of the show, she's always put back together again. And if you don't know how, it's a very convincing trick. And you'd say, well, he's a magician. That's just magic. Well, we know there's a trick. There's some explanation of how that magician does that. But if we're ignorant of it, it just looks like magic. Well, that's the way this is. It looks like those particles are magic. And that somehow they seem to obey the rules of statistics with a very specific statistical distribution in mind, and that's the diffraction distribution. I don't like magic particles. I just didn't think that was a good idea. And since I was doing this conscious research, I saw a logical explanation. The logical explanation is that in a reality based on information, which my consciousness theory said this reality is information based. So that another way of saying that is that it's a computed reality. And another way of saying that is that it's a virtual reality. These are all synonyms for the same thing. So calling it a virtual reality is saying it's an information-based reality. There are no particles. There are no waves. There's just information. Physicists are coming around to this. It was an idea that was kind of, only a few loners in physics had that idea. John Archibald Wheeler was one of them. Edward Fredkin was another. So there were a few scientists that thought our reality was information, because that's what quantum mechanics was telling us. But most physicists didn't know what to do with that. It's like, okay, yeah, so now where do we go? And nobody really knew what to do next. So in any case, a virtual reality has to be computed. And the computation can't be just random. Obviously, there's an intelligence behind the computation. There's something that organizes the rule set that defines the virtual reality. So that something is ordered. It's intelligent. You don't just make a virtual reality by, you know, randomness or without any intent behind it. Well, intent requires consciousness. Intent requires intelligence. So we have a virtual reality. There has to be some intelligent source behind the virtual reality. The information has to be computed somewhere. Well, in my model of consciousness, I also got a virtual reality, and the computer was consciousness. The consciousness is an information system. Part of that information can be arranged to be a computer. Part of it can be arranged to be individuated units of consciousness. You know, entities that make choices, that get in information, make choices, and can then transmit that information to other pieces of consciousness. So that was my consciousness model. And in that model, a virtual reality could be computed from a set of initial conditions and a rule set. So that's how you make any virtual reality. We have virtual realities today like No Man's Sky, and they're made from initial conditions, you know, in a rule set. That's how you make virtual realities. So the neat thing about virtual realities are, and I'm going to skip a whole bunch of details here, but we're just going to skip across the things that you maybe need to know to understand what these experiments are about. One of the neat things about a virtual reality that's computed is that the reality only exists in the minds of the players. Okay, you have a virtual reality computer that computes the reality. You have to have players. A reality isn't just going to be computed for no reason, right? There has to be a purpose. Things don't just create themselves for no purpose. If they do, they're unstable and they disappear for no purpose, you know, for no reason too. Things that are stable and very complex got that way for a reason. Okay, so if you have consciousness, the computer, and this consciousness computer is sending data to consciousness chunks called individuated units of consciousness who are receive data, interpret the data, make choices concerning the data, and then send information back to the computer that defines their choices, because their choices will change things in the data. Now you have a virtual reality, you see. So in this virtual reality, there is, you know, let's say this virtual reality has trees and rocks and entities in it, okay? Entities could be elves or barbarians or humans like us or whatever. Could be like The Sims, you know. It could be like a fantasy game. But in any case, the virtual reality computer sends information to pieces of consciousness who interpret that information as the virtual reality. So the virtual reality only exists in the minds of the players. It's a multiplayer game. So the computer has to take all the changes, all the choices that the players make. I want my player to jump up and down. I want my player to run away. I want my player to stand on one foot, whatever. I want my player to go over and hit that other player. You know, so they're all, these choices are made. The computer gets all those and computes the consequences and then sends a picture back to the player that shows what the consequences were according to the rule set, right? It was evolved with the initial conditions and a rule set. So that's the virtual reality, and that's how it plays out. It's really a conversation between the players and the computer. There is no real reality. That's the virtual reality. It doesn't exist. It's only information given to players. Well, it occurred to me that that answered this issue in quantum mechanics. When you look, when there is somebody who's measuring the which way data, which slit did it go through, you get particles. And when there's nobody measuring the which way data and you have no idea, you know, which slit it went through, you get a wave. You get a wave pattern. You get a diffraction pattern. So what is it about knowing that which way data that makes a difference between whether light is a particle or a wave? Well, it occurs to me that the looking at the data, the collecting the which way data, knowing which one it goes through, you now have a player. Okay? You now have a player who has information. And once that player has information, that's in the game. If he has information of a particle, then there's a particle in that game, and every other player has to see that particle too. But if there is no information in any of the players' data streams that they get, then there's really nothing that can be added to the virtual reality, because the virtual reality exists only in the minds of the players. So you see, if there is no information, there just is no particle. It's not there yet. If there is information, you do have a particle, and the particle will travel in a straight line and pile up behind the slit, like particles are supposed to do. Well, the system that is rendering this virtual reality has another problem, and that is, well, we send particles through, and the one that we can, when we look at the which way data, they pile up behind the slits. But when we don't look, the particle, you know, we still send something through. It's going to go somewhere. Where is it going to go? Well, the system had a boundary value problem it had to solve. It doesn't want discontinuities in the reality. It doesn't want things that just don't add up in the reality. Well, light wave is just a bunch of particles. A light wave is a whole lot of particles that are headed toward those slits all at the same time. But the fact that there's lots of particles there doesn't mean a thing. Each particle has to act like a particle. But we know that waves make diffraction patterns. So when nobody's looking, and there's no information about which particle it goes through, in order to keep a discontinuity out of the virtual reality, the system arranges those particles that are entirely uncertain as to where they went in a diffraction pattern. So now it has solved the problem. It doesn't have a discontinuity in the reality. Particles, whether they're one at a time or a billion at a time, all act just the same. The difference is that if you look at one and say, ah, it just went through this slit, now it becomes a particle at that slit because you've looked at it. It's information it had to send to some player, which puts it in the reality, and it can't do anything other than travel in a straight line and pile up behind a slit. If there is nobody looking at it, there is no data in this reality, it can't it can't act like a particle. Now it can act like a wave, and now you solve the boundary problem. You don't have this particle and wave duality, same thing, but it's two things. It's not the same thing. Well, these are the same thing, or it's not. Well, photons and light and waves and light, they're the same thing. So the system allowed the particles to distribute themselves in a diffraction pattern probability. So you look at diffraction pattern can also be a probability distribution. So it let it, distribute itself in a probability distribution that looks just like a diffraction pattern. So now light's consistent, particle or wave, works that way, it all works together. And scientists call that the principle of complementarity, something like that. That light was complementary to being both a wave and a particle. It depends on the experiment. If you look at it this way, it's a particle. You look at it that way, it's a wave. And they somehow decided it was both. And depending on the experiment, it would act one way or another. But there was no discontinuity, you see. One way you had to look, and when you looked, you created particles. The other way you didn't, and without looking, it acted like a wave. So when you're sending a beam of light from your laser pointer, you're not looking at each of the 100 billion photons that may be headed that direction toward the slit. You can't look at any of them, so you get diffraction pattern. Oh, see, the particles make diffraction patterns when nobody looks, and in a beam of light, nobody can look because there's billions of particles. So it's all consistent now. We have this consistent reality.